Flying is expensive. Why is this? Well, most would say it's because of the cost of fuel, but that's not entirely true. The Airbus A320neo can carry 6,400 gallons of fuel. That's the equivalent of 376 fully tanked Toyota Camrys. For every mile that the A320 flies, it burns 1.5 gallons of jet fuel. That works out to a paltry 0.67 miles per gallon. An A320 could barely fly from the Empire State Building to Grand Central Terminal on that gallon of fuel. To fly that 213 miles from New York to DC, that A320 needs 317 gallons of fuel. With that amount, our Toyota Camry could drive from New York to LA 49 times. But we do have to consider that a Camry only seats 5, an A320 seats 154. So, assuming that our plane is fully loaded, it now has a per-person fuel efficiency of 104.7 miles per gallon. That's amazing. According to the Bureau of Transport Statistics, airlines pay on average only $1.24 per gallon of fuel. So, flying from New York to DC, you personally only use $2.50 worth of fuel. So why do these tickets cost upwards of $80? Well, there's so much more that goes into your ticket price than fuel. Before we start, I'll quickly mention that these are all rough estimates. Many of these prices will vary widely through time, and there are certainly ways that airlines reduce these costs, but this will give you a general idea of what actually makes flying so expensive. The first thing we can add to our ticket price is crew costs. A pilot makes on average around $79,000 a year, which works out to about $44 per flight hour. We have two pilots, so for our hour-long flight from New York to DC, that's $88 to the pilots. A fully loaded A320 requires four flight attendants who are each paid around $38 per flight hour for a total of $152, bringing our crew costs up to $240. So, with our 154 seats, that works out to just about $1.50 per person in crew costs. Alright, now we're at $4. Next, we gotta pay the airports. New York's John F. Kennedy Airport charges $6.33 per 1,000 pounds of airplane taking off, and our A320 weighs 172,000 pounds. That means that we have to give $1,089 to JFK, or $7 per person. Dulles Airport doesn't publish their landing fees, but we'll assume it's about the same as JFK's landing fees, at $1,005 for a now 170,000 pound airplane. These fees generally include the cost of using gates, porters, and other airport resources, and divide down to $13.50 per person. Our total is now at $17.50. Now we get to the fun part, taxes. There's a litany of different taxes and they all vary by country, so for the sake of simplicity, we'll just cover the ones for the US. The simplest tax is the domestic passenger ticket tax at 7.5% of the ticket price. That money goes to the FAA. If you land or take off at a rural airport, which is defined as an airport with less than 100,000 enplanements during the second preceding calendar year, and either one is not located within 75 miles of another airport with 100,000 enplanements per year, two is receiving central air service subsidies, or three is not connected by paved roads to another airport, they also tack on another 7.5%. That, of course, doesn't apply to either of our airports. The FAA also charges $4 flat for any flight within the US, unless you go to Hawaii or Alaska. Then they charge $8.70. The TSA then adds a $5.60 tax called the 9/11 security fee that goes to fund the heightened security since 9/11. Those are only just for domestic flights. If we were flying from New York to Paris, we would also have to add $17.70 for the international transportation tax, $5.50 for the US Customs user fee, $5 for the US Animal and Plant Health Inspection Service fee, $7 for the US Immigration and Naturalization fee, and $14 for the French Civil Aviation tax. So, with all the taxes and fees that apply to this short flight, we're now at $33 total. Now, let's remember that airplanes are expensive. Our A320 costs $107 million. The service life for airplanes is not actually determined by flying time. It's determined by something called flight cycles, which is basically a fancy word for one flight. It doesn't really matter how long an airplane flies in its service life. What matters is how many times it's pressurized. This is because every time it's pressurized, microcracks develop around the rivets that connect the metal plates that make up the fuselage. No matter if a plane goes on a 30-minute flight or a 9-hour flight, the wear and tear to the plane will be the same. This is why large, long-haul airplanes are often older. They might only go through one flight cycle per day, while small regional jets could go through 8 or 10. So, back to our A320. Our plane is actually a pretty durable aircraft. It can fly up to 60,000 cycles. So if we divide the total price of our plane by the maximum number of flight cycles, we get that $1,783 per flight must be devoted towards paying off the initial price of the airplane. Per person, that works out to $11.50. We're now at $44.50. To keep this plane safe, airlines have to also perform regular maintenance. For our hour-long flight, an airline has to do maintenance that'll cost $646 in labor, $276 in parts, $603 in inspections and component overhauls, and another $596 in engine restoration. That's $2,121 total, or $14 per person. We're now at $58.50. We also have to consider the non-flying part of flying. Overseeing any flight is an airline, which is a business that has costs in and of itself. They need to pay administrators, executives, software engineers, marketers, consultants, customer service personnel, public relations agents, janitors, along with rent, benefits, travel costs, utilities, and more. It's hard to put an exact number on how much per person this works out to, but we'll make a conservative estimate of $10. We're up to $68.50. An airline will pay about $106,500 per year for insurance for an A320, and assuming our plane spends 8 hours per day in the air, $36 of this insurance is for this hour-long flight, or about 25 cents per person. Our very rough grand total is $68.75. We'll round this up to $70, since there are various small things I didn't cover, such as hotel costs for crew members, plane storage, APU rental, liability insurance, etc. That means that $10 of our plane ticket is profit. But keep in mind that all my estimates were on the conservative end, and it's all assuming a fully loaded airplane. In the end, not a ton of money actually goes to the airline. Back to my first line, flying is expensive. Well, it really isn't, and it's getting cheaper. To fly in the magic metal bird across the country from New York to LA in 6 hours costs around $340 round trip. To drive in our very fuel-efficient Toyota Camry across the country in 40 hours costs $340 just in fuel, then an additional $300 in estimated maintenance and depreciation costs. In the past 30 years, the average inflation-adjusted airfare has dropped by 50%, and it's still dropping. In 1974, it was actually illegal for airlines to offer a flight between New York and LA for less than $1,442 inflation-adjusted dollars. And now, you can sometimes find these flights for less than $200 round trip. One of the reasons for this drop in prices is the rise of efficient airplanes. Certain innovations such as composite construction, better aerodynamics, more efficient engines, and, perhaps most notably, winglets, has driven down the cost of flying. Here's the one and only real engineering to explain winglets.
As you said, the airline industry is constantly finding ways to drive down their fuel consumption. In the early 70s, fuel prices skyrocketed, and engineers were forced to find ways of making their planes more efficient. One way they found was with winglets, which are those little curly bits at the end of the wing. Let's have a quick look at how they work. Winglets were introduced to decrease induced drag, which occurs when high-pressure air below the wing begins to bleed over the edge into the low-pressure air above. This flow creates vortices off the tips of the wing that create drag and reduce lift, which reduces the fuel economy of the plane. Winglets act to reduce these vortices by reducing the airflow over the edge of the wing. For a full explanation and a look at the history behind winglets, head over to my channel and watch my new video, which features a special guest appearance from Wendover Productions.
Thanks, Real Engineering. Be sure to go check out and subscribe to Real Engineering's channel. If you like this channel, I guarantee you'll enjoy his. I'll leave you with the real reason specific airfares are expensive, but also a reason why they're getting cheaper. Competition. The airline industry is one with very little competition. Airfares from New York to LA are cheap because there's a lot of demand and there's a relatively high amount of competition. 5 different airlines fly direct from New York to LA, 2 of which are budget airlines. People don't care that much which airline they fly. They care about the price, so airlines will try to match the price of budget airlines. Compare this to a route like Denver to Gunnison County Airport. Largely because only United makes this flight, you'll often pay more than $500 for this 130-mile flight. So, that's why your plane tickets cost so much. Next time you book your travel, you'll know why you're paying so much and also how little of that actually goes to airlines. Thank you for watching. If you enjoyed this video, make sure to click subscribe. You can also click here to be taken to Real Engineering's channel. If you enjoyed this video, please share it on Twitter, Reddit, Facebook, StumbleUpon, Dig, whatever website you like. You can check out last week's video on an illegal number here. Also, please follow me on Twitter at WendoverPro. Lastly, I'd like to thank you all for your support and welcome all the new subscribers from the past few weeks. Next week, I'll be back to my normal series, that Wikipedia list.